All right. I will go by. I will go line by line, and I think one of my favorite ones, which is everyone knows this line. Oh, Romeo, Romeo, wherefore art thou Romeo? Oh, Romeo, Romeo, ¿por qué debes ser Romeo? Deny thy father and refuse thy name. Olvídate de tu padre y nega tu nombre. Or if thou wilt not, o si no lo haces, be but sworn my love. Promete que me amas. And I'll no longer be a Capulet. Y ya no soy una Capuleta. Very simple. O Romeo, Romeo, wherefore art thou Romeo? Deny thy father and refuse thy name. Or if thou wilt not, be but sworn my love, and I'll no longer be a Capulet.
The play is already done before you even begin. With the opening speech, the narration tells you in that this is the story of two young people who are from different families, who fall in love. These families have been feuding. They fall in love. They die. That's the play. Now we're going to begin the play.
I don't read this play as being about fate, that Romeo and Juliet necessarily are going to die, because my Romeo and Juliet do have free will. They choose to disobey. They choose to marry. But a lot of people like to read the play as about fate, that these two, Romeo and Juliet, have no chance.
So the course starts with Romeo and Juliet, and one of the reasons I love starting a Shakespeare class with Romeo and Juliet is because most people have read it before. Most people, if they haven't read it, they've encountered it somehow. And for me, starting with Romeo and Juliet is a chance for us to say there's another Shakespeare. There's the Shakespeare that we were taught in high school. There's the Shakespeare that we saw in a film at the multiplex. And starting again with Romeo and Juliet lets people realize that they can have a Shakespeare, that they can have a Romeo and Juliet, and that their interpretation of Romeo and Juliet can matter and can count in a way that might not have their first time experiencing that play.
My first encounter with Shakespeare was actually Romeo and Juliet. I think it was sixth grade or something. You have to read it for English class, sixth or seventh grade. I don't remember. But we read it for English class. I didn't understand a word of it. But our teacher, I remember, had us perform scenes from it. Me and a buddy, two buddies, it was three of us, decided to do the scene where Mercutio, Romeo, and Tybalt get in a fight. And we thought it would be cool to videotape it. And rather than perform it, we would videotape it and then discuss it. We thought that would be fun. And we all dressed up like Star Wars characters. So Romeo was Luke Skywalker. And Mercutio was Han Solo, of course. Tybalt, I think we kind of made up a Star Wars character for Tybalt. We didn't really want to turn him into Darth Vader. That would have been really weird. But so we recorded us fighting. And what was... Now that I'm thinking about it, like, what was actually quite interesting about it is that we were much closer to the age of the characters than I am right now playing Romeo. And so thinking about that is, like, what that story means when there actually is a 14-year-old boy swinging a sword around at another person. And imagine them having a gun and trying to shooting someone and killing someone.
So I love teaching Romeo and Juliet partly because it's a tale about street violence and what it might mean to live in a violent world and to be young. And I love that it's told from the point of view of a 13-year-old protagonist, a young girl. And so that, you know, I teach it, these students come in knowing it from high school, they're young, they live in a violent world, and they have sort of a sense of what it means. And I think being able to connect that to the sense that Shakespeare's decentering who the protagonist is of that tale and allowing her voice to drive the play. God, that's fun to teach.
To me, Romeo and Juliet is Juliet's play. It's not Romeo's. Romeo may think it's Romeo's play, but it's really Juliet's play.
She's not just some child. She's a real person. And if you're a good learner, if you're interested in understanding the world, you'll listen to her. and maybe you'll come to the point of view that this is how the world should be seen.
Every time you meet them at any point in your life, the world will break open for you in a different way. I mean, you will not meet Juliet at 16 the way you'll meet Juliet as a mom. Never. And the way you'll meet Juliet when you are old.
There never was such a tale of woe as Juliet and her Romeo, and that possessive her Romeo really gets us to sort of the question. It's, you know, it's a tragedy, but it's a tragedy about Juliet. It's a tragedy of a 13-year-old girl. It's not classical tragedy. It's something very different. And I think we see the playwright struggling to get at, you know, if I was going to wear my historicist hat, I would say we see the playwright trying to get at what the experience of early modern London was, a city that was growing exponentially. But we can also, I think why we're invested in it is that it's telling a tale about urban violence and difference and what it might mean to be young and think you can overcome that. And then also the sorrow when you learn you can't.
You have no way of controlling them. They are adults in their children body and they don't know. They don't know what they don't know, but they know what they know. And that Juliet is going to get herself into a bucket of trouble. And there's nothing that her mom can do to stop her. You just hope she survives it. And that's what every teenage mother of any teenager absolutely believes. At some point, you want them to know what they want, and you've got to have that. You've got to let it go. You've got to let them go. And sometimes they get hurt, and sometimes they die.
I didn't understand Romeo and Juliet until I fell in love for the first time. And I mean fell in love. And I wasn't 14 or 15. I was a lot older. I had been married once before. Still, when I fell in love and I got to say, I got to read the words, my bounty is as boundless as the sea, my love as deep, the more I give to thee, the more I have, for both are infinite. It's just, ah.
We're in the balcony scene, and I look up at Juliet, and she goes, all right, swear to me that you love me. And Romeo goes, all right, lady, by yonder blessed moon, I swear that tips with silver all these fruit tree tops. And she goes, no, don't swear by the moon. That doesn't make it, no, it's inconstant. You don't want to swear by that. And right then, at the end of that line, a bird chirped, and I look up at the bird, and I say, okay, what do I swear by? And I point at the bird, and the whole audience got what we were doing. What shall I swear by? This bird?
When I think about, no, it's the nightingale. It's not the lark. I could cry. I mean, that sounds so silly, but they're willing to just extend their disbelief for each other's. No, you don't have to go. You can stay. You can be with me forever. We can just keep pretending that the bird we're hearing, can't you hear it? I can hear it. That they create that reality for each other in that moment, and they use that simple poetry, that simple it's so sensual, and it's so kind. It's so kind.
I love teaching the sonnet in Romeo and Juliet, and I love teaching it because it's unexpected. A lot of people read it don't realize that the first words that Romeo and Juliet speak to each other are in the form of a sonnet. And I also think it's lovely the way that they exchange lines in the sonnet. Romeo speaks the first quatrain of the sonnet, Juliet speaks the second quatrain of the sonnet, and then they share the third quatrain, and then the final couplet each says one line of the couplet. And then they actually begin another sonnet immediately after. And they have their kiss just in between the two sonnets. And there's something really lovely about the fact that they end, essentially that the sonnet ends with a kiss. Most Shakespearean sonnets have a turn at the end, and this one has a quite literal, physical, visceral turn. And I love that they immediately start a second sonnet. They've got one kiss, they're going to go for another. And so there's this bodiness. And if you read the language, it's quite sexual. So we're not just talking about a meet cute where, you know, it's these two cute young people who see each other, but there's actually a kind of raw abandon, sort of a passion that is in the lines.
I think listening to Shakespeare can be a big challenge if you're trying to catch every single word and try to understand every single thing. I think if you get a group of people who understand what plays are about and understand what the play is, that you could have no experience, you could never see a play before in your life. You could hate theater. You could think Shakespeare is terrifying and awful. You could never have heard it in your entire life, but if you have a group of people that know what they're doing, then you'll find something. And if you're not stressed about trying to understand every single word, you will be able to relate to and connect to something. You'll be surprised at what you're able to grab from these shows and from this language. There's a way of this rhythm in Shakespeare, and there's something that's just incredibly relatable. And it's this heartbeat. And you could not understand a word that's being said, but you will understand the emotion that's behind it.
The words are some of them archaic, but once you get the really, really understand what they are and really get them in your mouth is one of the key things, I think, for me. Because it can be like rocks in your mouth at first. But it's just lack of familiarity. It's not lack of ability. It's just that you haven't done this a lot.
But you aren't going to get there here. You aren't going to get there here or here. You can get there here, and here, and here, and here. All of that will be necessary to get anywhere with it.
Even just the texture of the word in your mouth, if you say it, I think that this is part of why it's so important to speak Shakespeare aloud, is because he actually understood that words, and you know, many authors understand this, that words actually have texture as we say them. They actually move our mouths in certain ways.
The words are meant to be spoken out loud. And reading them silently to oneself, you don't get the sense of the language in your mouth and understanding the root of the language, and then not being afraid to be curious, to go back in to figure out, you know, in the annotations, what does it mean? What does that phrase really mean?
If you approach it first as a story, take it on its own terms, I think you'll be able to parse out things within that story that you may not have been able to have reached had you just thought, well, the language is difficult. This is Shakespeare. I have to say something profound about Shakespeare.
And so, you know, I sat with my dictionary with the annotated version and with an alternate version that I had run to one of the bookstores and bought, and just sort of compared it. And every night it was an exercise that really completely changed my relationship with the English language. It completely unlocked for me what I had always, as a bilingual speaker, it unlocked something for me with the English language.
When I first started reading Shakespeare, I would translate each line into Spanish to see just what the different feel would be, especially a word like, if you have the word fire. I say fire in English, and I say, okay, I understand what fire means, but when I say fuego, oh, when I say fuego, I understand what fire means.
You know, I just finished directing a play in Louisville called The African Company Presents Richard III, and it was about the play is around the facts of the first black theater company in the United States in 1821 and how the white theater, the dominant theater at that time, the Park Theater, shut them down. So here was a company of black actors performing Richard III, and then of course the Park Theater had a production of Richard III going on, and how the audience was being weaned away from the Park to the African Company, and how they were using the dominant language, or this language of Shakespeare, which is this cultural product of, you know, sort of refinement and all this other stuff, and how they were making it their own, And I think that's what it is, of being able to own the language and make it your own and not make it be some kind of an abstract idea about something.
I am afraid to think what I...
I am afraid to think what I have done.
I am afraid to think what I
have done. I am afraid to think what I have done.
Very good.
Not only what you say, but how you say it can mean so much. It can have so much power behind it. It can literally break lives or make lives. You know, it can make things better or worse. Like, words are the beginning to me.
You can go back to the books and say, what does that word mean to me? In my culture, in my language, in my body, in my being. Because nobody can tell you that. You know, that's yours, and that's the great joy of Shakespeare, that you can make each and every word yours.
It's most powerful when you can tap into the different ways to experience Shakespeare. Then it becomes, again, even more elastic, and can resonate in throughout different registers of your life too.
I think there's something in poetry that just can really tie a community together. It can let us care more. And that sounds super cheesy, I know. But, I mean, I think if we all just cared more about each other, which is a lot of what Shakespeare's plays are about. It's just, I mean, Romeo and Juliet, that whole play is about it's not just about these two lovers. It's about two families who hate each other unite and stop fighting.